allocate their money.
You brought up Slack, so let's go there. What, you own 10% of the company? You're on the board. I know you're limited about what you can say as a result of all of that, but when can we expect it, and why the direct listing, and do you agree with that decision?
I love it. I mean, I think that the decision-making that Stuart has taken is incredible, both in the way that he's built the company, he's transforming the culture, he understands the product to a level of sophistication that I have not seen since Facebook. You know, when I was in the bowels of Facebook building that machinery, what I saw was a team that really understood product market fit and the power of network effects and why that created an incredibly subsidized business, a thing that could expand all over the world at marginally zero cost. The only company in the world that looks like that today that is not yet public is called Slack, and it will be soon. And so from that perspective, I think it is the most incredible business that we have seen. Probably the next closest thing to it is a company that just went public recently, which is Zoom.
So we obviously talk a lot about, you know, these hot new IPOs coming to market, valuations. You know, some suggest, you know, some are getting a little over their skis, the way that these numbers have been pushed up. Do you agree with that? You look at all of these that have come out recently.
So look, another big reason why, you know, I took a step back from the traditional investing game is that that game is in part rigged, but it's also in part fundamentally broken. Why? Because as you raise more and more funds with the goal of just generating fees, you need to allocate those into companies that are seemingly reasonable, where you won't lose your job. What that's resulted over the last 5 years is an enormous glut of money that has gone into enterprise software businesses. Why? Because there isn't this binary product market fit risk bet. There's some revenue. You're selling a product to a customer who's willing to pay for it. But the dirty underbelly of all enterprise businesses is that you spend an enormous amount of money on sales and marketing. So much so that right now, most of those companies have no line of sight to being profitable. And some of those companies are actually gross margin negative. And they're all raising capital from venture capitalists on the back of this idea of growth, 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 growth. Now, I look at that and I say to myself, all of these venture investors are telling me that because they like enterprise, I actually should take a step back. When they are greedy, I am fearful. I particularly don't like the enterprise space, X of Slack and probably Zoom. And there's maybe a handful of others around the edges. But beyond that, I would not put a single dollar in enterprise. It is overbuilt, it's overinvested, they're highly, highly unprofitable, and the real winner is Facebook, Google, Amazon, and Microsoft. So from my perspective, the actual companies of value right now are consumer. Look at the multiples of Facebook for the amount of cash they generate. Look at the multiples of Google. Look at Amazon themselves. Those are incredible businesses that you can own, which are much, much better bets.
Well, you're describing sort of obviously well-established and thriving businesses. I'm somewhat surprised to hear you say that the enterprise side is the one that's overvalued, whereas the consumer side looks reasonably valued when a lot of the consumer companies are not profitable, you know, and have no roadmap really to profitability.
I think the conventional wisdom there is a little misset. Again, I think that right now investors have a tendency to be late to the party. And when the music is on, as my friend Bill Gurley says, they love to dance. And right now, the enterprise world is the one where investors can look smart enough to their LPs to raise subsequent funds, which is really a backdoor mechanism to just generate more fees and pay themselves a salary. And so enterprise as a class is very challenged. There are a few like Slack, which are exemplary, but most we will find are incredibly overbuilt, overstaffed, very difficult to get to long-term sustainable profitability without being acquired by the big stalwart enterprise companies.
I mean, there's a you know, Snowflake is one that's hanging out there. We discussed it with our multitude of guests yesterday. That's in the enterprise space, the data cloud storage, a hot area. You look at two companies in the enterprise space. I say Zoom and Slack, and then everything else is garbage.
If you need to spend money to acquire customers, if I'm a buyer of stocks, what I will tell you is be very careful of the company that fundamentally does not have a product that is compelling enough to win customers naturally. And that the way you overcome a reluctance to use one's product is through the brute force use of money. By hiring salespeople, by spending on ads, by taking them to events and to dinners. If you as an investor look at those line items in a company, you will understand how good the product is or isn't. And then subsequently, what one should look at is how obvious it is for them to generate an incremental dollar from the dollar they've spent, or what we call negative dollar churn. And when you look at those, what you see are companies that are awash in horrible business practices and fundamentally crippled businesses that are subscale. And so if you like the enterprise, which I do, you want to find ones that have a natural law of expansion that is not coupled from how they spend money. There's Slack, and then there's Zoom. Everything else, as far as I can tell, literally everything else, you have to spend money to make money. And unfortunately, the money you make right now is at best break even and sometimes less than what you spend. That is not the economics of how one makes a sustainable legacy business.